few points about cardiac output and what are the factors influencing it. So the book which I am referring to is AKGEN. So if you define cardiac output, if you tend to define cardiac output, let me change the pen, kind of seems weird. So the amount of blood which is pumped out by each ventricle into the circulation per minute is called the cardiac output. So few points, it is per each ventricle, it is per minute, and it is pumped into the circulation. Whereas if I say that the amount of blood pumped by each ventricle per beat, if I change this to per beat, same definition which was for cardiac output becomes for the stroke volume. So just merely by studying this point, we can say that cardiac output is equal to heart rate into the stroke volume. Number of beats per minute is heart rate, so if I multiply it, I'll eventually get the cardiac output. So the normal stroke volume is 80 ml. Okay, so the cardiac output naturally comes out to be 5 to 6 liter per minute, or we can say 5.5 liter as the average. So the output of each ventricle is exactly the same. So this is going to be true. This should be really true because there is no apparent loss of, you know, the blood as it goes from the right ventricle to the left ventricle. So obviously the pumped out blood amount will be same for both. Then this is made possible since the two ventricles are connected in series. So what they are basically trying to say is that the right ventricle and left ventricle, they are connected in series. Okay. So if I have a container which is connected in, let's say, series, and let's say I have some kind of liquid filled in here, so automatically when it goes from this side to this side, it will be the same. So therefore this book mentions they are connected in series. Next, let us talk about what is control of cardiac output, what are the factors that control the cardiac output. We'll keep it really simple. So as we know that cardiac output is equal to heart rate into stroke volume, so the factors that would be influencing heart rate and stroke volume, which will actually be determining cardiac output, agree or not? So let us take them one by one. If we are going to talk about heart rate and the factors controlling it, we'll call it extrinsic autoregulation. Why we'll call it extrinsic autoregulation? First of all, we must know that let us say if this is, I'm drawing a diagram of the left heart. So this is the left atrium, this is the left ventricle, this is the aorta, and this is the pulmonary artery. Sorry, pulmonary vein. So this whole setup has a myocardium in it. So this myocardium is controlled by or governed by cardiac innervation and cardiovascular centers. Arteriometric. So hetero, if we go into details of heterometric, we'll say hetero means different and metric means measure. So what they're gonna say is that with the changing length of the initial length, to justify the statement, changing initial length of the myocardium is proportionate to the amount of contracting force. Okay, so this particular thing is known as Frank Starling law. Is that clear? So this effect is independent of the cardiac innervation. This line is written in EKG. So obviously this is not in relation to any of the, you know, cardiac innervation. It is merely depending upon the initial stretch of the myocardium or the initial length of the myocardium. Very nice graph is given of Frank Starling law, and we must remember one thing, that it is within physiological limits. It is within the physiological limits. So if we go into heterometric regulation, we must know that what we are saying that we are talking about initial length of the myocardium. When we say initial length of myocardium, we mean how much it is stretched. And what is the thing which stretches the myocardium? Well, it is the preload. Here is a tank and it is filled with water. Okay, and here I have a person whom I give a responsibility to submerge this weight plate, which is approximately of, let us say, 20 kg, and I tell him to put this here. So the amount of force which is present in his hand, this much, is the preload, and when he will be pushing this blade at the bottom of this well, the resistance which would be being offered, this resistance would be known as afterload. So the preload basically is the end diastolic volume or the amount of blood which is present in the ventricle during the diastole. Okay, that is the end diastolic volume. So whatever factors which would be, you know, increasing the end diastolic volume or increasing the preload, that will cause much more of the stretch, and if it will cause much more of the stretch, definitely it will cause more contraction, which means more of the stroke volume. So what are the things that would be increasing your end diastolic volume? Well, definitely it will be venous return. Let us talk about venous return. So what are the factors affecting venous return? Number one is your thoracic pump, or you can say it as the respiratory pump. Next is your cardiac pump, and at the end you can also mention about muscle pump. These are the major ones. After that we have total blood volume, we do have your capacitance. We also should discuss about body posture, body position, and seventh is the ventricular compliance. Let us take them one by one.